All right. Yo, what's going on? What's going on? What's going on? So, like, what's up? Yeah, what's going on? I gotta give y'all 30 more seconds before I start this. We're gonna go ahead and get started. Yeah, that was a great interview that Robert did, though. That was real awesome. This is part two of an interview that he agreed to do with me. You know, he's talking about living with HIV and how a lot of people, how everybody, they need to get tested. And and he say at first the stigma was it was a thing where you died from HIV. So that ain't it ain't like that no more. So he go on to share how he's living with it, how he got a productive life now, how if you do the right thing, take your med, how you can go on and live a regular life. He talks about his emotions when he first found out, how he found himself, and how he's okay with it. So I'm gonna go ahead and get that started now.
Hey, how you, Robert?
Yes,
so,
sir.
All right. So, can you share your personal experience with HIV and how it has impacted your life?
Okay. In our first segment, I shared to you about the code blue, right? The code blue,
right.
Death call. Okay, the reason it became a code blue is because when I got addicted to specifically crack cocaine, right, trying to recapture the single life, I became promiscuous because of the disease of addiction through crack cocaine controlled everything about me, especially my mental capacity. And so I ended up developing AIDS, which turned into full-blown AIDS, what they call full-blown AIDS back then. This is the time that when it was the highest epidemic on the market, so to speak. And so
when was this? When did you find out specifically?
Late 90s.
That's when you found out you were HIV positive.
Not HIV positive, full-blown AIDS.
Yeah, full-blown AIDS.
Full-blown AIDS, what the medical terminology was called, full-blown AIDS, the late 90s. And so, but I knew what my symptoms were and what I probably had and what I did have. I just was in a state of denial.
Okay, so how did you first become aware? Like you knew. But as far as medically, when did they say, okay, this is what you got? How did you first become aware that of your HIV status?
Because if you remember, I shared that I had taken some college classes before. And so we did some presentation in sociology. And so, that's when I learned about crack cocaine, because I took some rocks off the street to present, and my hand shook like a son of a gun. And we also learned about, this is like when HIV AIDS hit the market, and we learned about AZT, which was a drug that was supposedly non-life-threatening, but life-saving. And so Even in 1987, we started learning about this stuff in high school. And so, but I studied enough academically wise to know about the symptoms. And so when I knew that I was out there in the street and became promiscuous, and I started to develop some of the symptoms, you know.
Late 90s.
And I was stuck in my disease of addiction, and I started to develop symptoms. Weight loss, loss of appetite, what they call thrush of the throat. And so, but I went from place to place, you know, county to county, so to speak, you know, because wherever I went, my disease went with me until I got to Charleston homeless shelter. Meeting Street in back then. Now this is, I don't know if it still existed. And then I had developed the carposes and stuff on my arm. I lost weight.
The what on your arm?
Called carposes.
What are those?
Little patch marks.
Okay.
And then but to a full extent of it is when I had developed pneumonia, double pneumonia. This was back when they had pay phones.
Okay.
But you know what I mean? Pay booth. Payphone. So I sat by the payphone and I said to myself, because I was tired of running, Brother Lou, you know, in the streets of getting high and everything. And I said, I'm ready to go home by the fake payphone. And so
when you say home, what did you mean home?
Coming back to UCLA.
Okay.
And so, but when you just emphasized home, a voice whispered in my ear, and it wasn't a human voice, said, you might be going home to die. But I shook it off, you know what I'm saying? Because I knew what I had.
Full blown.
I knew what I had because I was that smart enough to know my health status.
Okay.
And I knew what my symptoms were. And so I just shook it off and I called mom and my family and they came to get me from the payphone booth. I was still sitting inside the payphone booth on the sidewalk. And so they came to get me. And so I came back home. I did some work and everything, you know, construction work, you know, and then I ended up getting real sick, double pneumonia. And so no one knows their child like a mom's intuition. So mom said, take my baby to the hospital. So I went to one facility and I was diagnosed with having bronchitis, but I knew I had more than bronchitis. So 2 weeks later, I got even sicker. The double pneumonia had set in, I could hardly breathe and anything. And so mom said, take it back. So they took me to another hospital. And when I got to the hospital, I knew what the emergency room physician was going to tell me. So he comes back into the room and he says, Mr. Pierce, I said, yes. He said, you want me to tell you the diagnosis in front of your family member? I said, sure, tell him. Because I already knew what it was. You know what I'm saying? And he said, you have full-blown AIDS. And so I just dropped my head. That was kind of like concrete confirmation.
What were your thoughts and emotions at that? You knew because you that smart what you had, but when a doctor confirmed it, was it something in you saying, gosh, I hope that ain't it, though. I hope I'm wrong.
No, it wasn't shocking me.
Okay.
Because I knew.
So what was your thoughts and emotions at that time with your family when he told you?
Because I told him to go ahead because I knew what I knew.
Yeah.
And what his concrete medical confirmation was just concreted on top of what I knew. And so I said, sure. And I felt kind of like nonchalant, but not as a not caring point. It was just like, okay, it's finally out. Relief.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And so he said, well, we're going to admit you. We're going to have to immediately admit you. And so they did. And then one of my niece, she just comforted me and my sister comforted me, said, it's going to be all right. But then back then now, if you can remember, it was called a death sentence.
Late 90s.
It was called dying from. Today it's called living with. So I said, so they admitted me and That was on a Sunday night. And on a Tuesday, I had to have a biopsy because I've had so much abdominal pain. And so on the way going to the examination room, my eyelids started blinking uncontrollably. Something else I learned about pre-death stages with some people. And so I did this, try to stop it from blinking. They wouldn't stop, but I was still in high spirits, you know, joyful little person as I always was. And so when we got to the examination room, the anesthesiologist was on my left-hand side, my second older sister on my right-hand side. And so the anesthesiologist, and I'm laying down on the bed, and he says, we're going to give you something so we can run the tube down your throat to see why I was in so much abdominal pain. I said, fine. And so I'm looking at him as he's getting ready to inject me, right? Mm-hmm. And before he could touch me, I had an out-of-body experience. My breath left my body, and I knew I was not in it. My second oldest sister on the right-hand side, the anesthesiologist on the left-hand side. So when I came to myself, Brother Lou, I was on my hands and knees, and I was up there in space on my hands and knees, but my physical body was laying in bed. And so I looked to the left, I looked to the right, I didn't see the darkness of stars, but I knew I was not in my body. And I said, Lord, where am I at now? And when I said that, I looked straight up off my hands and knees and in the doorway. That's where I saw the God of my understanding. And I went into prayer. If it's your will, not yet, let me live a little while longer to spend time with my mom and my daddy, my brother and sisters, and see my daughter grow up age. Because my daughter was only 13 years of age then.
Okay.
And today she's 33. So that was 21 years ago. And so, and I can remember just like it was yesterday. And so I prayed and I prayed and prayed.
So they told you, so when you, so you pray, you came back.
I came back, and back in my body.
They told you that you had, the doctors even say that you went to a cold blue.
Yeah, they called a cold blue. Uh-huh. Because on the, when that happened, when my soul left my body, they immediately called a cold blue.
All right, so you stay in the hospital, you get back healthier and all this stuff somewhat. Have you had to face any challenges managing your HIV?
At first I did, because I was still in the full-blown stage age. I had a handful of damn pills I had to take every day. But now it's just one a day pill. And it would make me sick, especially if I had to take it on, if I took it on an empty stomach. But also, there were pain medication given to me.
Okay.
And so, me being the tough person that I thought I was, you know what I did with the pain medication? Sold them, some of them, for money to accumulate. So, when I did get better, I could buy my drug of choice.
Okay.
And so, that's what I told you when I had to learn how to walk again for 90 days. I walked down the street to get crack.
So... compared to when you first heard about HIV when you didn't have it, mm-hmm. to when you finally found out that you did have it, what changed as far as your mindset?
I started to have regrets. Part of that emotional devastation and spiritual devastation that was unprocessed and unaccepted. See, all of this came into play of trying to validate myself through myself, but always felt I needed to be validated by others.
So there was a lot of, so before you was actually diagnosed with it yourself, when you heard about it or someone else having it, was there any stigma?
No, because I always have been a compassionate person. That's why I'm so glad that Destiny and I met in human services, being able to help serve others. You see, okay. That's a compassionate feeling. You know this, right?
Yeah.
So, but when those that have contracted it and thus passed on before I ever did, I never judged anybody because who in the heck am I to try to judge somebody? Okay. You see what I'm saying? I've always had compassion for people.
So, can you discuss any stigmas or misconceptions you have encountered regarding HIV
since you have
back then?
That, no, that you have had with other people that know of your diagnosis. Have you
some any? Not all. Some are more acceptable now because it's not called dying from now, it's called living with. It's a whole different ball game, you know, because back then they didn't have so much as adequate treatment. Today it's one of their pill. And being undetectable, I can stay undetectable as long as I comply to take my medication as prescribed.
So sitting here today, you're undetectable.
Very much
what
so.
What makes a person undetectable?
When your CD4 count is more than 200, that means your white blood cells. And when your viral load is less than 20, viral load is the amount of infection you have in your body. The CD4 count is similar to the white blood cells that help fight off infections.
So can a person that's undetectable have unprotected sex with a partner?
You can, but you know what? It's your own personal choice to be advised. But the medication that is prescribed today, you cannot contract HIV from an undetectable person. But to be personally on a safe side, I would suggest to always be
safe. Practice
safer than sorry. So
okay.
You know what I'm saying? But being undetectable means a person can only be prescribed a one a day pill. And hopefully if there's no other any impending health issue, you know what I'm saying? Okay. That it's livable with now, Lou. It's not like it was back when it hit the market. In the mid 80s on up to the late 2000s, where it was kind of, mid 2000s, yes, when it was deemed a death sentence. It was called dying from.
So, but today you're not dying from,
no,
you're
sir.
Living with.
It's called living with.
Okay, so with. To someone out there, because you never know where this is going to go.
Mm-hmm.
To someone out there that may have just gotten the news that they have HIV, mm-hmm. What would you tell them? Look into the
camera. I would say seek out medical attention, follow through from your medical provider, and just know that it is livable with. It's not a death sentence anymore. People, just like with certain other medical conditions, if treated and treated correctly, we can live and live a productive, joyous life. You know, I have HIV. HIV doesn't have me because I have graduated with my bachelor's degree in human services. I am currently employed in a recovery field. I am healthy. I have a healthy appetite. I am loved. I love myself. That's, you can't get no more productive than that.
So what about them educating themselves?
And also, yeah, definitely. Good point. The more we know, the more we grow. So learn to educate ourselves each and every opportunity we get about what may be personal for the betterment of our development. Yes.
Okay.
Just don't give up the fight.
Mm-mm. So are there resources or organizations that's helpful for people out there?
Yes. There are resources such as, first start with the medical facility, which would actually give you all the current resources available. But also you can research on your own. There are magazines that are published directly for those of us living with HIV as far as encouragement wise. There are pamphlets and stuff at any medical facility that house the cases for HIV statuses. The help is available,
okay.
More so now than it ever was in the past. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's all about delving into what you want to learn to find out about your health condition and how it is manageable.
When you first got diagnosed, I know you knew you had it before you got diagnosed. Mm-hmm. Well, since you've been diagnosed, when you first got diagnosed, did you care more about disclosing it or like just keeping it to yourself, not like, when did you get comfortable with, you know what, I'm living with it. It is what it is. When did you get comfortable with it?
When this healthy black nurse came in while I was dealing with acceptance of it. And she came in, and you wouldn't think that she was positive, because she looked so much, she was so healthy and beautiful in her physique. She says, because I was distraught, you know, because I had also thought that, okay, all right, I'm at the end of my lifeline now.
Okay.
So she came in and she says, Robert, listen, she says, this is not a death sentence, because we live just day with illnesses and stuff. And I didn't figure out what she was saying until she said, I'm HIV positive. But I mean, she was thick bone, and she was educated, and she had she was in her career zone. You see what I'm saying? Okay. And I looked at her, and even one of my physicians back then told me, this when I had gotten out of the hospital and started getting into a medical program to learn how to get better. Okay. And the doctor said, you're one of the ones we're not gonna let fall through the crack. Because see, emotionally wise, I was distraught, Lou. I didn't see nowhere else to go. Because society had done shunned everybody, not just, you know, locally, but all over the globe. What, you know how they treated people back then.
What are some prevention methods?
Prevention method is youth protection, PrEP. There are medications out there.
What's PrEP?
PrEP is medication or either an injection before that you can take to prevent from getting HIV.
Okay.
PrEP is a pre-measurement where you take either you can't have HIV and take PrEP. You have to be non-HIV and to get PrEP in case you do sleep with someone who may be HIV positive and it won't be transmitted.
So you don't take PrEP if you were sleeping with somebody that wasn't HIV positive. They are the ones that would take PrEP.
The person who is not HIV positive would be taking PrEP. If they slept with someone who is HIV positive, that it's not transmissible.
Okay. So you got safe sex, you got PrEP.
And most important, get educated.
Get educated. Mm-hmm. Okay. Because a lot of I just hugged you. Do that mean that I'm HIV positive?
No. So that damage, we got shared a brotherly love.
What if my sweat or some spit, you know?
No. But see, it is transmitted through sexual, unprotected sexual contact. A mother can transmit it from her
to her fetus,
yes. And blood transfusion. Blood. Okay. Other than that, that's it. But now blood transfusion is now actually run through a database system where it is checked out before the HIV antibody. Okay. You can't give blood if you're HIV positive either.
Okay.
Yes. And you shouldn't, because you never, I mean, it would be like intentionally trying to infect somebody.
How often do you recommend people that are sexual active get tested?
Every 6 months. Because the virus usually will show up within a 6 month time frame.
Okay. Let's see. That's the last question. Is there anything else you would like to share about your journey with HIV, or any message you would like to convey to others?
Yes, HIV or not HIV, just love each other, because love actually what makes the world go round. You know, I didn't need, because when I became positive, I felt I was unlovable until I started learning how to love myself. First, I had to remember God still loved me. It was just up to me to start loving myself. And if anybody else didn't, oh, well, that sounds like OPP, other people's problem.
It's a lot of people living with it the day that's scared and afraid to let someone know or let someone in, and they not taking care of themselves.
That's when.
How do you overcome that fear?
Make a decision to be bold, brave, and bodacious about living, and not concerning ourselves to be validated by other people's opinion, because it's all about life and my life and maybe, our life together,
and maybe saving somebody
else's and life. Saving somebody else's life as well.
Closed mouth don't get fed.
Hey, thank you. And a closed mind won't have an open mind if it don't try to open it up.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Exactly. So, thank y'all so
thank
much.
You thank again, you, brother. So much. I love you, my brother.
I love you, man.
I love you.
Always too, a brother. Pleasure, man.
I'm going
great
home.
Job. All right.
Getting out of your house. Ain't no days
ain't
off.
No days off.
Ain't no days off. They already know that. Ain't no days off, man.
Yeah. I really like podcast. I really like doing this right here. You know, you get to know people, you get to spread awareness, you get to talk, you get to it's really crazy. It's really crazy that I even got a platform to be able to do this. And for you to understand how crazy it is, you really got to know where I came from. Like, no fabrication, no lies, not nobody else's story. You really got to know where I came from to understand how all this is just crazy. I like to joke. I like to smile. I like to laugh. I know y'all see me acting crazy. I'm off the chain. It ain't always been like this. I always couldn't afford no food. I always couldn't afford to. No rent. I always couldn't afford the no place to live, you know. I done stayed in some really crazy places before. Parking lot garages, abandoned buildings, abandoned duplexes, the park. I done stayed in some crazy places before. That's why I'm so humble, you know. And I'm so grateful, 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 grateful. I'm just real grateful, man. Every time I think about where how I was before I got clean, it was bad. Jails, institutions, homeless, jobless, penniless. Like, it was real bad. I got a Thanksgiving special coming up. Y'all really gonna want to check that out. We're gonna go somewhere. We definitely gonna go somewhere. This is just the beginning of it. You know, the grind. It's just the grind. It's just the part like where you first starting up and you gotta grind. Like, you gotta edit. You gotta edit all your stuff. You got to edit it. You got to sit in front of the computer. I got to be to work in 4 hours, and I'm still trying to edit because I don't put a time on it. Like, I got to film my own stuff. I got to produce it. Like, I got to share it. Like, it's a whole lot with it, you know. And sometimes I'll get caught up with like who's supposed to be sharing it or who not sharing it. And, you know, even in my head, like, yo, I shared everybody's stuff. I ain't even have to like it, and I shared it. But, you know, I got to remember, like, this is my dream. It's my vision. It's what I want to do. It ain't nobody else's. Like, don't nobody, I owe me. Don't nobody else owe me. I owe me. So, like, I edit, I produce, I chop. Just this week, like, was the most discouraging week ever. 4 people counseled on me in 1 week. 4 people said, I can't, we set the appointment,
Like, I had done went, got some stuff. It's called per person. It's like I like to set up themes sometime. I had done went and got stuff. I was so excited. And four people counseled on me. Four. You know, ain't number 7 days in a week. Like, I'm really working. I'm really trying to have content. So, like, I can put out content right behind. You know, it was kind of discouraging a little bit. It was real discouraging a little bit, actually, you know. And, you know, it's all good. We'll book another date. But, you know, that come with the territory, right? Because I know if I stay consistent and if I keep grinding and if I keep going, like, I know already, because I know how my hustle is. Like, my daddy was a hustler. My mama was a hustler. And when I say hustler, I mean they worked. They didn't sit around and act like that's what they did. Like, my family. And, you know, like, and I know if I stay consistent and I keep on grinding, I know this thing, I can go anywhere. I can go anywhere. But it was really like, this has really been a rough week. And I still don't put out two great, great, excellent, wonderful interviews with two wonderful people, but it's done been a crazy week. Like, for like, I couldn't believe it. Like, I had booked all week and like four people counseled on me, you know. And you know, I ain't mad, I ain't upset. It's kind of discouraging because I feel like, sometimes, like, if I was flying them out, putting them up in, but I ain't there yet, you know. I will be there. I'll be sitting here watching podcasts on TV, thinking how far they are along and how they got a good start, you know. But this is where I'm starting at right here. This is the studio. Ain't no days off, you know. You can get some water, you can get some chips, you can you can take a shower, bath, like, you can get a ride, get a few dollars, like, that's it right now, you know. Man, I just hold on, man. I just hold on. I done came a long way. But y'all be on the lookout for that Thanksgiving special, man. It's really gonna be a Thanksgiving special, you know. And I know it's gonna be special. Y'all gonna be spending it with your loved ones and friends. Might get to spend it with me, like, who knows? Who knows? I'm just real grateful, man. I'm happy. I'm in a good place. I ain't too much going on. Everybody, my family all right, my friends all right. Like, really ain't a lot going on. I'm really in a good place right now. I know that can change over at any time. So I just stay grounded. That's how I do it. I just stay grounded. I keep it real with myself, keep it real with my friends, keep it real with my family, you know. Yeah, that's what I do, man. Didi, thank you. You real, real supportive. You be liking and sharing. And yo, thank you. That mean a lot, because like, not all, like, just getting my content out there, it's hard to get discouraging. Like, sometimes you do an hour live and you get like one view, you like, you just ready to throw it all away. You online for an hour and get one view, you know. It's discouraging, but I ain't giving up. It make me go harder. It make me show me where my grind really is. Yeah, it make me go harder. Yeah, I just go harder. Like, you be online 2-3 hours. I don't know why my thing keeps zooming in. But yeah, you be online 2-3 hours and you only get like two views. And then you go to somebody else live and they sitting up there smoking a cigarette and they got 1,000. Yes, man. You be... yeah, I'm looking at the bigger picture though, but you be online, I be online for 3 hours and I think I be talking about some real deep stuff that everyone has been affected by, and I get like two viewers, and then I stroll down and go to somebody else page, they smoking a cigarette, they got like 800 viewers,
I'll be like, but man, I'm gonna hold on, you know, I'm gonna hold on. I'm in it, dude. I'm gonna hold on, man. I'm gonna keep grinding, I'm gonna keep going. Y'all already know, like, and you know, I am in recovery, but I don't want y'all to think like if you come on my podcast, like we just gotta talk about recovery. No, we can sit down, we can have a conversation, we can laugh, joke, cry, like we can do whatever on my part. It's mine. Like I make the rules. We can do whatever up on here. I don't want you to think just because you hear a lot of like that's the only thing that we do on my podcast, which I am a person in recovery, but we can talk about grandma, we can talk about kids, we can talk about school, we can talk about work, we can talk about airplanes, cars, swim. It don't matter. We can talk about anything on this platform right here, you know. But man, like I'm just real grateful, man. I'm real humble. What it say? It's coming. Keep it coming. When I say everyone I know should be watching, in my head, like I think a lot of, yeah, I think like that too. But yo, the beginning is what really makes you. The beginning is what really makes you, because I done seen people like, I done seen people blow up overnight, right? I mean, blow up out of nowhere overnight, and then like, out of nowhere, they just start taking blows and they don't know how to handle it because they didn't start at the bottom. Like they just start taking blows out of nowhere and they not built for it because they blew up overnight. They blew up too fast and they not built for it. I'm going to appreciate the ground. I'm going to appreciate the floor. Yeah, this ain't my first time eating off the floor. I'm going to appreciate right here. So when things do happen and they do come for me and I do start taking them blows, I'm going to be built for it, you know. I done seen it happen so many times with so many people. Yeah, blew up overnight and got there and didn't know how to handle it. People start crucifying them and hating on it, and they broke. And when I say broke, not money wise, but I'm talking about mentally wise, like they was here one day and then the next day they was way at the top. And then when things started to come their way so fast and people started to hate on them and the money wouldn't come, they didn't know how to handle it. So that's why I'm appreciative of where I'm at right now. Do I wish I was I don't know why this thing keep doing that. Do I wish I was farther along? Yes. But I'm going to take this time right here while I'm down here to reflect. So when I do get up there and everything and things do hit the fan, I'm going to know how to handle it. I'm going to know how to deal with it. Yep. I'm going to keep it real. Post something that's not effective. Their family members, maybe even themselves. Post something that's not effective. Look, I've cleaned 20 pounds of chitlin' watching and getting some truth. Well, I appreciate it. I really appreciate it. Thank you. Share. I did 2 interviews. One talking about addiction. And one talking about HIV. I did 2 great interviews. If y'all saw them, or if y'all happen to run by, I know y'all got pretty pages. But if you could share something, that would be great. If you can't, that's still great. Thank you for viewing. Thank you for watching. I don't know why this camera keeps zooming in like that. Cut that light on. So I'm real grateful. I really appreciate it. I really appreciate everybody, man. Like, I really appreciate it. Like, y'all done showed me so much love. I can't wait to get a platform so I can get us all together and we just be in one big building, just singing so loud and dancing the night away and everything, you know. But I'm about to get out of here. Got to be to work at 6 o'clock in the morning. Just thinking about that makes me so tired right now. Got to be to work at 6 o'clock in the morning. Got to get up at 4:45. Got to have my coffee made. Got to feed Mischief and Mayhem. Like, so yeah. So I'm gonna get on up out of here. Thank y'all. Y'all have a great, great weekend. Make some memories. Be safe. But whatever you do, wherever you go, whoever you talk to, you make sure you never, never, never forget. Hold on. Ain't no days off. Ain't no days off. All right, y'all be good.